Good afternoon and welcome to St. Ambrose. Our opening song today, and all of our songs are in the Breaking Bread hymnal in the pews. Our opening song is number 558, Glory and Praise to Our God, number 558. Please stand.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you all.
And with your spirit.
The Lord Jesus is with us. He promised always to be with us where two or more of us would be gathered in prayer, gathered in his name. If we do not recognize him, this is an occasion for us to pray for vision, to pray for eyes of faith with which to see. Let's present ourselves humbly before the Lord now, acknowledging our own need for healing and forgiveness. Lord Jesus, author of life, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, victor over death, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, our hope, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
To God in the highest, and on earth, peace to people of
Let us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was a man commended to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God worked through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This man, delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed, using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from the throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, 'I saw the Lord ever before me, and with him at my right hand I shall not be disturbed. Therefore my heart has been glad and my tongue has exulted. My flesh too will dwell in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor will you suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You have filled me with joy in your presence. My brothers, one can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is still in our midst to this day. But since he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that neither was he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did his flesh see corruption. God raised this Jesus, of this we are all witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured him forth as you see and hear." The word of the Lord.
Our responsorial psalm is number 508 in the Breaking Bread hymnal. My happiness lies in you, I love.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, if you invoke as Father him who judges impartially, according to each one's works, conduct yourself with reverence during the time of your sojourning, realizing that you were ransomed from your futile conduct handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a spotless, unblemished lamb. He is known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Proclamation of the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Lord.
That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. And they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looking downcast. One of them, named Cleophas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word, before God and all the people. How our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described, but him they did not see. And he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish are you? How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?' Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
God is good
all the time.
And all the time. So I want to thank you for praying for me while I was on journey to Georgia by road to and fro safely. And greetings from those people down there. So you all remember on Holy Thursday in the upper room, Jesus instituted the Eucharist. And today, while they are walking to Emmaus, and that encounter with those two, Jesus is, in a sense, celebrating Mass with them. In what is happening today, we can see all the parts of the Mass. So, you know, we have four parts in Mass. We have the introductory rite, which is from the entrance hymn and runs through to the collect, the prayer which when the priest says, "Let us pray," it is called the collect, because at that time when the priest says, "Let us pray," and pauses for a moment, you ought to throw in your prayer there, your intention. Collecting all our intentions. Then we move in to the liturgy of the word, which runs from the first reading to the prayers of the faithful. And once we are done with that, then we proceed to the liturgy of the Eucharist, which runs from the offertory procession till the prayer after communion. And then we have the concluding rite, which is the blessing, the dismissal, and the concluding hymn. These four parts of the Eucharistic celebration are recognizable in the Gospel passage of today, which describes the encounter between Jesus and the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. So in a sense, Jesus is celebrating Mass with them. I would like us to take a look. In the first part, we see that the two disciples are running away from Jerusalem because they had lost hope in Jesus. They speak about Jesus in the past tense, and their story shows a lot of confusion and discouragement. They had invested 3 years or so on Jesus, and apparently everything had come to a standstill. Now Jesus joins them in their situation of hopelessness and begins the celebration of the Eucharist. He collects, he listens to their concerns as he walks with them. Then Jesus builds a close relationship with them and establishes a context in which to share with them the Word of God. So you see there's an introduction there, now moving to the Word of God. In the second part, the liturgy of the Word, Jesus begins to challenge the two. He uses the Word of God to suggest some deep meaning to the recent events in their lives, that they had not simply wasted their life with Jesus. Then, starting from Moses and going through all the prophets, he explained to them the passages throughout the scriptures that were about himself. So their hearts were burning with them as they listened to him on the road. Then, having established a relationship with his disciples and having shared the Word of God, now it is time for the liturgy of the Eucharist. And this is the third part of the Eucharistic celebration. Now Jesus pretends as if to travel on. He gives them an option to see if they would want to go on beyond the word they just heard to the word made flesh. Then the disciples invite him, "Stay with us, Lord. Stay with us." So Jesus goes on to stay with them. And now, while he was with them at table, he took bread and said the blessing. Then he broke it and handed it to them. These words sound very liturgical, and perhaps they have come from the celebration of the breaking of bread in the early Christian communities. And we are told, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, but he had vanished from their sight. Now, they invited Jesus, "Stay with us, Lord." Then, as soon as their eyes are opened, Jesus vanishes. Why? You know, the reason, Lord, cannot be contained within space and time. It cannot be limited. So he vanished because he wanted to be present among them in the Eucharist. So he could be present. He's present here at St. Ambrose. He's present in France, in Asia, in Africa, all over the world. Then, after recognizing the risen Lord, the disciples feel empowered. And now they want to go back to Jerusalem to share their experience and to give hope to those who are still waiting to experience Jesus. And this is the fourth part of the Eucharistic celebration, the dismissal and the mission. We are told that then they told their story of what had happened on the road and how they had recognized him at the breaking of the bread. Now, what was happening to those two disciples as they walked through the different parts of the celebration with Jesus himself? And what should be happening to us as we journey through the different parts of Mass? In the beginning of Mass, maybe we come with our own problems and issues, and perhaps we are frustrated, we are discouraged, and we say, "Oh, what a life." we may be feeling like running away from our responsibilities, running away from our faith, running away from our communities. So the introductory rite of the Mass welcomes us and makes us feel at home and invites us to acknowledge our state and feel comforted or comforted by the penitential rite. Then in the liturgy of the word, we listen to the word of God. And this part of the liturgy helps us to find meaning to the events of our lives in the light of the word of God. So the purpose of the scripture readings and the homily is basically to find meaning to the events of our present life and to become aware that everything is under a watchful eye of God. And at the end of it, we are able to say, yes, everything does have meaning. Then to deepen that meaning and to climax it in a God experience, we move on to the liturgy of the Eucharist. The liturgy of the Eucharist gives us the possibility of experiencing God in Christ. We experience Him as risen. He is alive. He is with us. He has not abandoned me. And He gives me hope. So this is the core of receiving communion. We get strengthened to continue our lives meaningfully. Then finally, having experienced Christ, we are now ready to go back to where we came from. Maybe nothing would have changed in our environment, but since we are empowered by the word and the sacrament, we want to bring hope to our situations. So we are sent as apostles. Go in peace, alleluia, alleluia. So we are sent out. We go back to where we came from. Those disciples go back to where they came from. They go back to Jerusalem. So through this Emmaus experience, and through our experience during Mass, we would like to ask that this celebration, and indeed every Eucharistic celebration, be an opportunity for us to experience the risen Lord. And may this experience transform us and empower us to transform the world around us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Let's stand together now and profess our faith. I believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and him, for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit, who was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. He rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead,
and his kingdom will have no end.
the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen.
Let's bring our prayers now before the Lord, confident of God's goodness, recognizing our own need.
That the church may continue to be the standard bearer for love and compassion for all people in need, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all leaders of state may be guided by the Almighty in the just use of power, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who suffer or grieve may find meaning through God's mercy and love, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all received into the church this Easter may continue to be led by the Lord on the path of life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who have died in Christ may rejoice forever with him in glory, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the soul of Laura Boykin, who passed away on Tuesday, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in our book of intentions and those calling and requesting prayers, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our sister diocese in Ludwar, Kenya, our sister parish in Guatemala, and our St. Ambrose Parish family, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Pat McGuire and Teresa Fleach, for whom this Mass is offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's call upon our Blessed Mother for her intercession as we pray.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
We pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our song during the preparation of the gifts is number 311, Table of Plenty, number 311.
I will.
sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept our sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, this time when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. Through him, the children of light rise to eternal life, and the halls of the heavenly kingdom are thrown open to the faithful. For his death is our ransom from death, and in his rising, the life of all has risen. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Sending down your spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of Jesus' death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, St. Ambrose, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by Jesus' own divine teaching, we dare to say, Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
O Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's give one another some sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion song is number 477, Shelter Me, O God.
Set me high above their reach.
The Bishop's Annual Appeal begins today and helps fund various ministries and programs within our diocese. Our 2023 parish goals are $59,620 and 100% participation. We ask that each one of us prayerfully consider how the stewardship of our gifts can benefit the church throughout Southwest Michigan. Your generous contributions are highly appreciated. St. Ambrose will be sponsoring a table at the May 11th Right to Life dinner. We invite you to join Father Mike and Father Albert at the St. Ambrose table. Please call the office to reserve your seat. Thank you all for participating in our campus cleanup this weekend. Have a blessed week.
I just want to say something about the Bishop's Annual Appeal 2023. And first, I just want to thank you so much for what we did last year. We did very well. We went over our goal, and we are getting back more than 5,000, which will help us to do that. We have a project which might cost about 100,000 to redo something, to rework or to refreshen this worship space. So that will go in there. Now, this year, you heard we have is 59,620, and I believe we are going to make it. So I want to tell you that, you know, the Bishop's Annual Appeal, it happens all over the place. I remember when I was back in Africa before I came over this way, the bishop appointed me to be the rector of the cathedral. And now we had the bishop's annual appeal. There they call it Family Day, which is a friendly name. So then the bishop gave me a challenge and said, okay, since you are at the cathedral and the cathedral is the mother church, so your target will be the highest. So my target was 800,000 Kenya shillings, not US dollars. So 800 Kenya shillings is about 8,000 US dollars, which is a lot over there. Now, then that year, the bishop gave an incentive and said, the parish which will surpass their goal will get an extra used truck. So you know the vehicles are not owned, they are owned by the diocese. I can't afford to buy a car for myself. So the diocese buys the car, you use it there. When you move, it remains there. You'll find whatever is in the other place we are going. So I told the people, now we are the mother church, and do you love your parish? They said, we do. Would you like to be, if you love your parish, would you like to participate in all the activities of the parish? They said, we do. So our parish motto that year was, my church, my pride. So my church, my pride. So if you are proud of your church, you cannot let it down. So there are those who are not employed. So I said, whatever God has given you, just offer that one to God. So everybody participated. So I had people brought me chicken. Others brought some goats. Even there was one man who said, I don't have anything. I have 50 camels, but I'll give one. So they brought them to the parish. than those who are working give in terms of money. And believe it or not, we were able to raise 1.5 million. So when we presented 1.5 million, it was historical. So we got a new used truck. They still have it up to now. So back in Kalamazoo, God has really blessed us in so many ways. I think even John Paul said, nobody is so poor as to lack anything to give. And nobody is so rich that he can't receive anything. So God has really blessed us here. So if all of us participate, even if you have chicken, I'll take it. I know we shall make it. And even go over, just like last year. And just to mention a few things which happens here in the diocese, there are quite a lot of things which happen, which the diocese uses that money for. You know, next month we have two ordinations. One gentleman will be ordained priest at the end of the month, and another one will be ordained deacon on 20th. And to educate the young men preparing for priesthood, part of that money pays for their education. Then we have programs for married couples. Those who are preparing for marriage, there are programs offered by the diocese, funded by that. We also have our Catholic schools. You know, apart from the subsidies which we give subsidies every parish. We give subsidies to our Catholic schools to make them running. But also apart from that, there are some programs offered for the administration, which is covered by the diocese through using that funding too. Then we have deacon formation. Now our deacons are retiring. Deacon L retired last year, and Deacon Hal is telling me he wants to retire this June. But we have some who will be ordained deacons. Mm-hmm. When will that be, Father Mike?
August or September.
Yeah, towards the end of the year. And to pay for their learning, which takes 6 years, the diocese pays using this money too. Then the confirmation which Bishop does with the presence retreat is funded using the same money too. In our diocese we have the other programs for immigrants. We have the Hispanic ministry, which is also funded by that bishop's annual appeal. Every year we have the 50th wedding anniversary for couples celebrating 50 years. Also, the diocese sponsors that too. And those in the service, we normally have the Blue Mass. Those serving the nation, I don't know, in various capacities.
Police, first responders, fire people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all those, they are also taken care of. Then we have a newsletter coming from the diocese every, I think it's every month, the Southwest magazine. So it's also funded by that. Then the youth program too is taken care of by that. And we have also a scholarship for students attending Catholic school. So those are just among the many things which that bishop's annual appeal does once we submit to the diocese. So I would like us to, I know if all of us participate, actually if you do the math, if all of us participate, it's very easy. That 59,000 will not be a big deal. So God has blessed you. Whatever you give, God is even adding more. You know, we normally say, if I want to give you something and you are a tight fist, even if God puts something there, it will fall down. But once you open like this, you give and then God puts double or triple, then now you are even better. So I just want to encourage you. I know we'll make it. By the end of next month, we'll be celebrating. So let's go for it. But what do you say, Father Mike?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much.
While we have your attention, let's pray this prayer. Heart of Christ,
renew your priest in your love. Help them to devote themselves more deeply to building up your body, the church, so that we may all become one in your life and love. Let your Holy Spirit kindle the fire of your love within our hearts. Help them to set the world on fire through the faithful practice of their priestly ministry. May we support and encourage our priests with our prayer as they strive to be good, holy, compassionate, inspiring pastors for us who are entrusted to their care. May we grow to be faithful and joyful witnesses to your presence in our world. With your word of blessing, help all our families to encourage each other to respond to your invitation to follow in our particular locations. Help many more men come in and respond to your call to serve your church and priestly ministry for our diocese. Loving and merciful God, since the beginning of time, you have been making all things new. Call our world back to you, deepen our faith, renew our priests, and guide our entire diocese, priests, and people through this life and into the everlasting life of heaven. May we proclaim with all our hearts, you are my Lord and my God, as you renew us in your life-giving love, now and forever. Amen.
Let's stand and pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you were pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless us all, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Our closing song is number 732, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.